योगः कर्मसु कौशलम्।
Hello friends, section 3 would focus upon interrelationship of course and curriculum. One major problem we will highlight is the tendency to design courses that have little or no relationship to the curriculum that is in place or to the critical skills students need to acquire for that matter. Most observers and researchers agree that the sequence of courses our students take is more serendipitous than planned. These scholars frequently describe the educational experience of our students as disjointed, fractured, and totally unstructured. But if the curriculum, the courses, and the process of learning are not carefully integrated to produce clearly conceived learning outcomes, what else can we expect? The research suggests that in many cases, college and university curricula do not produce the results we intend, and we know that very well for that matter. Curricula that are not focused by clear statements of intended outcomes and that permit naive students broad choices among courses can result in markedly different outcomes from those originally imagined. By graduation, most students have come to understand that their degrees have more to do with the successful accumulation of credits with the purposeful pursuit of knowledge. Every institution should aim to ensure that by graduation, all students will have reached those goals that the faculty agree and appropriate and will have the skills, attitudes, and competences associated with their major and minor. Your challenge as you design a curriculum or develop your course is to ensure that these goals can be attained by those students who meet the requirements. As it is believed, the educational payoff of a coherent curriculum is that students come to understand the connections in theme that convert a diversity of curriculum parts into a whole. It is the job of a text and teachers to make such relationships visible, but they must be pointed out in the first place. Let us move on to course design and the delivery of instruction. As it is said, all the faculty, employers, and governmental leaders agree that graduates need critical thinking and complex problem solving, communication and interpersonal skills. Research shows that the lecture is the predominant method of instruction in higher education. To ensure that students develop the higher level competences that you determine to be essential will require thinking about how time is spent, both inside and outside the classroom, and perhaps the rethinking what your role as a faculty member should be. A basic reference library on teaching, learning, and assessment is important. Most of our personal libraries are extensive. They also tend to be rather narrow, focusing as they do not on our discipline and our particular field of specialization within. Few of us spend much time reviewing what is known about teaching and learning or exploring the various methods of students' assessment available to us. Nevertheless, our working knowledge in these areas will help to determine our effectiveness as teachers and the quality of our courses and curricula. Accountability is also vitally important. A serious problem that institutions of higher education face is the perception by business leaders, governmental leaders, and the public at large, and that they have enthusiastically avoided stating clearly what competences graduates should have, and that as a result, they have provided little evidence that they are successful at what they are expected to do. Unfortunately, these perceptions are not far from the truth. The public demands for assessment of programs have, for the most part, fallen on deaf ears. And as a result of this inattention and also major budget problems, higher education in general receives increasingly less support from the public and private sectors. Looking into the rationale, evidence, and criteria of curriculum and course designing, insofar as rationale is concerned, it requires a high level of disciplinary expertise. It can have major impact on students' motivation, learning, retention, and attitude towards the field of study, can also increase interest of high quality students to a major in field, and by improving learning meets the stated goals of department, school, college, and institution. Now coming to evidence. It is related to the descriptive essay, including ability, statement of needs, and rationale for design. Syllabi or students' manuals are also important. Newly created course materials are important. Video of class presentation in an innovative manner is important. Students' rating becomes important. Students' performance data, focus, if on appropriate and specific population, also becomes vitally important. Coming to the criteria of curriculum and course designing, it shows high level of disciplinary expertise. It represents an innovation or new approach in design, delivery, or content that can be replicated. It focuses on learning outcomes that are clearly stated and match the course objectives. It meets needs of student population being served, and stated instructional goals is approved by department and curriculum committee. The above mentioned approach has several additional characteristics that significantly affect its success. By using a person who is not a content expert to facilitate the design process, this model allows you and other faculty to focus on content and structure while ensuring that assumptions are questioned and alternatives are explored. The model also allows you to focus first on what an ideal program would look like, eliminating perceived limitations, many of which turn out to be more imagined than real. Furthermore, the model is data-driven, using information from a wide range of sources to help determine scope, content, effectiveness, and efficiency. This systems model places technology in perspective, using it where and when it is appropriate. Finally, and equally important, although this approach requires hard work, faculty find it exciting, challenging, and rewarding, and administrations remark on its efficiency and effectiveness. The model follows a specific sequence that begins with an assessment of need and a statement of goals, which is followed by the design, implementation, assessment, and revision of your course or curriculum. As departments, schools, colleges, and universities under an external mandate to assess the quality of their academic programs are finding out, no matter where you begin in the process, you will need to go back to the statement of need before you can develop a statement of goals on which assessment must be based. For example, to assess your program, you'll need to know first where you are trying to go, and then based on this information, you will need to develop an assessment program that can help determine whether you are successful or not.